And I guess the first thing that we should alert everybody is that it looks like Matt Hardy is okay.
He was going to the hospital to be checked out. So this is the situation that happened. So he was wrestling Sammy Guevara, and they were kind of like in the, what would be the patio area of Daly's place next to the stadium. And they came off a forklift, and Matt Hardy cracked his head. They were supposed to have tables to break the fall. Sammy Guevara and Matt Hardy both came crashing down. And Matt Hardy, I mean, he hit the table, but his head, like, hit the floor really hard.
Well, let me jump in and say that there were, in fact, two tables there. They completely missed the first table.
Right.
Matt went, like, his legs went through the second table, but
His legs and his body, but not his head.
Kind of his body. I mean, he mostly missed the second table and just splatted on the cement, and he was out.
Yeah, it looked bad. So they were trying to figure out what to do. At first, Aubrey Edwards was kind of keeping Sammy Guevara away and trying to, like, get Sammy Guevara to just kind of, like, do something, just don't touch him for a little while. And then they decided he could touch him. And then Tony Khan made the call. Now, Aubrey Edwards did the X sign, but that was Tony Khan in her earpiece, basically saying, I want to stop it. So they stopped it. And then, you know, it was over, and that was that. And then Dr. Samson, you know, examined Matt, and Matt wanted to go, and Dr. Samson said it was okay to go. So they restarted it and just did the finish. They didn't do, like, anything that was planned for the match. They just went right to the finish, which was climbing up the lighting grid and taking another stunt fall. But this time it was only Sammy who took the fall into a crash pad. And that's what happened. Sammy took a big fall into a crash pad and didn't get up by the count of 10. And Matt Hardy won and didn't have to leave the company. So there was a lot of controversy. You know, obviously, there's a lot of similarity between this and what happened with Johnny Gargano and Ridge Holland a couple of weeks ago on NXT. And like I said on that one and saying on this one, it's like, you know, it's probably best to err on the side of caution. Matt went through concussion protocol and he passed. So that was the doctor's call on this.
Well, let me stop you there for a second, Dave. So Johnny Gargano got dropped on his head,
yep.
But there was no indication that he was unconscious. Matt Hardy was completely unconscious for like 45 seconds. I thought the guy might be dead. He was completely unmoving. And I have absolutely no idea how you can do concussion protocol in the 4 minutes between when the bell rang to stop the match.
I don't, and when it
was restarted.
I don't either. I felt that they should have erred on the side of caution, sent him to the hospital, and if he's okay, they could do the match Wednesday, or they could do it a week from Wednesday if he needs, or 2 weeks from Wednesday, or whatever, whenever he's ready. It didn't need to be done right now. Risks were involved in everything like that, but they did clear
him. It's not even that. It's when he took the fall, okay? When Aubrey waved off the match, they were both actually on their feet, okay? So yeah. There was no reason to need to continue this match. You just say, she stopped the match, they were both on their feet. Nobody lost. I mean, if you're worried about the finish, she called for the bell when they were both standing up. And that's by far like the least of our worries.
They should just call it a no contest and then done the match that they needed to do at a later date when he was okay. That's why I agree.
So I'm still baffled as to how he got cleared in that 4 minutes. I mean, you cannot do concussion protocol to a guy who was unconscious in 4 minutes. What, you ask him what day it is, he answers, you look at his eyes. I mean, shouldn't this be an impact test? Shouldn't this be like a full-scale medical examination? I mean, he's stumbling around for 4 minutes. How can you get a concussion protocol in those 4 minutes? It's ridiculous.
I have no idea. I, like I said, I figure, I don't think that they should have gone on with it, but You know, it is the mentality of the wrestlers to want to go, but that
doesn't matter.
It's not his call. It's the doctor's call, and the doctor cleared him. Okay, should the doctor have cleared him? I'm not the doctor. I wasn't there for the protocol. I would say that you err on the side of caution, and you don't do it. They cleared him, so that's what happened.
Listen, I'm not a doctor either, but the obvious question would be, how do you clear someone who was just unconscious for 45 seconds? How?
I'm going to guess that he was not unconscious for 45 seconds. Okay? If he was unconscious for 45 seconds, I can't even imagine that you would clear him. I don't know.
Well, he was unmoving for a considerable amount of time.
I'd have to go back and rewatch as far as like how long he was unmoving. He was down for too long, but he was up. But I mean, it was like he certainly didn't look like he should be wrestling again. I mean, I didn't get any indication of that. And when he came out, you know, it's like, no, I mean,
he had to be helped to climb the scaffold.
He climbed on his own. That's
Sammy was there, and he was assisting him.
He climbed on his own. That he wasn't being pulled up. That also was kind of concerning, because if he lost his balance climbing the scaffold, you know, I mean, he could fall off of that, and that wouldn't be any good either. But you know, he did climb it. He did not seem steady. I didn't sense that he was steady whatsoever. I just felt that, you know, I don't know why they, like I said, I can't see why they didn't just let it go and do whatever you needed to do, do it some other time. Everyone would have understood, and everyone did understand. I think people were more upset that the match went on than upset that, like, we didn't get the match that was advertised.
I don't think you would have had one fan angry if that match would have been called off.
Nope.
Not really.
Well, what? And if they were, that's screw them. You know, you got to understand that when something bad happens, you know, the health comes first. You got to understand that. So, yeah, like I said, I don't think anyone would have been upset. And I mean, whatever. If there were people upset, then they don't get wrestling. So I was uncomfortable with the thing going on. And, but again, like I said, I don't know what happened there. I just know that I was uncomfortable watching it.
I think at the end of the day, it doesn't matter if it's AEW, New Japan, WWE, wherever. I think that if you are rendered unconscious legitimately in a match, whether it's for 5 seconds or 45 seconds or whatever, it's over.
Agreed.
It's over.
That should
be the concussion protocol.
Absolutely. 100%. It should be over, and then you should be checked out and cleared when you're cleared, not, you know, whatever. I don't know how long he was out. I don't know what the situation was. I mean, Matt Hardy might explain it later. But even so, he was, I didn't feel good about watching it. You know, I felt
his wife was furious, absolutely furious.
Well, of course.
She says the number one person to blame is Matt, which this poor
guy. Well, no, it's not. It's.
I'm telling you what she said.
Okay.
And she said the number two person she won't name, but you can figure it out.
Okay. Look, it's Dr. Samson's call. Okay, so he is number one, number two, and number three. I mean, I guess if you're going to have a number two, it's Tony, you know, but he's not going to overrule his doctor. So it's going to be Dr. Samson, and that's his call, and you'd have to ask him, and I don't know that, you know, he's going to be up for questioning. I mean, Matt wanted to continue, but that's not his call. I mean, I've seen enough situations where they say, well, the guy wanted to do it. It's like, again, and it's the same thing that I said about, like, some of the guys, you know, wrestling during COVID that had immune problems, it's like, it shouldn't be their call. That's what medical should be there to save guys from themselves, because everybody wants to do it. You're conditioned to do it. You're conditioned in training to not quit, because people get hurt all the time. And number one rule is you go to the finish. But that's what the doctor comes in. The doctor's rule should be that.
We talk about this all the time in UFC. Like, if it's the talent or the fighter's choice to decide whether or not they can continue, what do we need a doctor for?
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you what. I mean, look, we've had a lot of problems with UFC doctors, too. I mean,
that's my point. Like, we should be learning from this.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Hey, look, Michael Bisping fought how many years with one eye? And I still don't know how he got cleared everywhere. I mean, I guess he figured out how to gimmick the eye chart, but still, I mean, that's a real indictment. And he went, you know, he went in good commissions and bad and all over the world and, you know, fooled everyone until he retired.
I should say, by the way, that I don't, from reading her tweet and her text message, I don't think that Matt's wife was upset that he wanted to continue the match. I think she was angry that he agreed to take a spear off a scaffold through a table to the cement. That was the impression I got.
Well, it was risky as hell. I will say that. And, you know, I was uncomfortable with a lot of the things that were done, like the Darby Allin bump in the Battle Royal. He was fine, you know, and look, most of the time in these situations when you take these risky moves, the guys are going to be kind of okay. But there's certain things like again, I don't know about being in a body bag and being power bombed over the top ropes out of the ring. You know what I mean? I am, you know.
Dude, I saw that. I thought the guy was dead. I mean, it was a high angle. You can't see where you're going. You don't know when you're going to hit. But apparently it was just like a roll and he was completely fine. But still, I mean, I feel that like.
I was scared watching that spot, though.
You have to, and this is, whether it's Tony Khan or whoever, you've got to be able to say no to these people sometimes with their crazy ideas. Like,
agreed.
There's some crazy things that we have seen in AEW. And, I mean, obviously, in WWE, the problem is, for the most part, and this is not, like, universally.
Hold on, Dave. They do crazy stuff in WWE.
I know, but hold on. My point is, in general, everybody that leaves always talks about how they have all of these ideas and they're never used, okay? That's the extreme in one direction. But the extreme in the other direction is like, anything anybody wants to do, they're allowed to do. And obviously that's not the case in AEW.
That's not the case in AEW either, though.
But I do believe that some of these people need to be told no for some of these crazy ideas. A power bomb over the top to the floor inside a body bag where you can't see?
Yeah.
That's crazy.
Look, I remember Kevin Owens doing stuff that was just absolutely insane. And I remember when, like, you know, that was when it was like, oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Because that's when they were doing the whole thing about how, oh, you know, we can't have guys do the crazy stuff they do in New Japan. And it's like, I never seen anyone in New Japan do anything like that. So it's like, it's more of an American thing than, I mean, I'm not saying it's not Japanese. Japanese is a different situation. And there's crazy stuff in Japan, too, in the smaller companies. But, yeah, it's, I mean, it's like, I saw the Darby thing and it's like he was fine, but it's like at some point it's going to catch up to you. You know, it's like what the Young Bucks do, just as an example. They do all kinds of crazy stuff, but it's within reason and there's like nothing that in their matches that other than the one bump Nick Jackson took in the table sliders and chairs match that scared me to death. I mean, it's always something where, yeah, you know, you can get hurt and all that, but it didn't like scare me to death because they're like pros and most of the time they're going to hit it. Even though, you know, there's always a risk. There's always a risk, even with the simple stuff.
There's always a risk, but there's a risk and there's being reckless. And I don't think in the calendar year 2020, I've seen one thing in a Young Bucks match where they themselves were being reckless. I've seen accidents a couple of weeks ago when Matt accidentally got dropped on his head when they tried the spot outside, but that wasn't his fault. I mean, yeah. It was a slip. But as far as like doing things that are reckless, I never see the Young Bucks doing anything reckless.
Yeah. No, I was saying that what they do, what they do a lot of high risk stuff, but it's stuff under control. Whereas like but Darby does a lot of stuff that's reckless. You know, and he's always done it. He did it before AEW, obviously. But this one was, yeah, it was pretty crazy. It was pretty crazy. But the Matt thing, I mean, in theory, they had the two tables set up, but they needed a third one because he went too far. But whatever. I mean, it put a damper on the show for a lot of people.
I was out of the show for like an hour.
Yeah.
I could not get back into that show for like an hour. And people who were there, I mean, they never got to see. They saw no replays if they were in the crowd. And so they didn't really, I mean, they kind of knew what was going on, but I mean, I was told that the big issue was it was so hot.
It's very humid and
it was,
hot.
It was humid and hot, and
well, that's why guys like slipped on some spots.
Seidel almost killed himself. That was another
Seidel one. Almost killed himself on the shooting star press, which is like his first move when he debuted. Yes, yeah, so that was really unfortunate. Because it was hot. I mean, that's the problem of being outside on a super hot day. I mean, Moxley said when he woke up, he knew it was going to be trouble. Actually, his wife was there, and she was the one who told him. It's like, you know, they woke up in the morning, and it was already hot and humid, and it's like, oh, that's going to be great. And it absolutely affected everyone in every match, because these were long matches, is that it was humid as hell. But so that was, you know, but that's what happens when you do an outdoor show in the summer. You're going to, in Florida especially, you're going to risk that. But the outdoor, you know, I mean, that's the deal. So a lot of things went wrong.